प्रतिबोधितां भगवतां नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन क्रदितां पुराणमुनीनां मध्ये महाभारतम्। साक्षिभूतं भावादीतं त्रिगुणरहितं सद्गुरुं तं नमामि। वार्ताय प्रतिबोधितां भगवतां नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनीनां मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वा मनुसंदधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी। वसुदेवसुतं देवं गंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। I welcome you all with my love and respects. Eighth chapter, Art of Leaving. Here, Krishna speaks about the death. Krishna speaks how death can become a liberation and celebration. Death is death as long as you don't understand it. The moment we understand it, it becomes liberation and celebration. Death is not end of the life as we think. It is climax of the life. End is different, climax is different. The moment you think death is end, you start worrying about it. You start bothering about it. You have started creating more trouble for you. The moment you think death is going to end your life, death is end, you will start creating worries. Just because of that worries, even your life will become dull. Even your life will become dull. The shadow of death will happen even when you live. A man who is not able to understand death, even when he lives, he will die. He will be like a living dead. Person who understands death, he will live even his death. Person who don't understand, he will die even while he is alive. Person who understands, he will live even when he dies. death or life is not incidents, it is your intelligence. When you have clear intelligence, you will live even your death. When we don't know, when we don't have clarity about death, even when you live, you will be dying. Arjuna starts with a beautiful question. Kim tat brahma kim atyatmam kim karma purushottama adibhudanja kim proktam adidaivam kim uchyate. He is not ready to stop even for Krishna's answer. He goes on. Adi yanya kadam gotra dehesmin madhusudana prayana kale chakadam neyo siniyadatmapi. Beautiful two slokas. Of course, when I translate into English, the whole taste is lost. That's a big problem. We don't have right words in English for so many beautiful words described here by Arjuna. Because the single word will have so many meanings in Sanskrit. When you translate, the whole juice is lost. The moment I translate, I have to give only the one dimension, a single dimension of this sloka. Arjuna says, my Lord, what is Brahman? What is the self? What are fruitive activities? What is material manifestation? And what are the demigods? Please explain to me this. Who is the Lord of sacrifice? And how does he live in the body? O Madhusudana, and how can those engaged in devotion know you at the time of death? One important thing you should understand about Sanskrit. Sanskrit is not only linguistic, it has got importance even in the phonetic level. The very vibration can transform your mood. Just now you heard beautiful chanting of our temple priests. See, the very vibration is enough. Will change the whole mood. The very sound will change the whole mood. There is something called pada and padartha. You should understand this concept. When I say the word cow, when I utter the word cow, immediately a figure appears in your mind with four legs, one tail, a head, two arms, a figure appears in your mind. The word is called pada and the figure is pada artha. The word is pada. What happens in your mind once you hear the word is pada artha. In all other languages, the distance or the gap between pada and padartha is more. In Sanskrit, immediately, instantaneously the result happens. That is why I always tell people, even if you don't understand, it's okay. Every day, 10 minutes, just utter some Sanskrit sutras or stotras, whether Bhagavad Gita or Vishnu Sahasranama or Shiva Sahasranama, any Sanskrit mantra, any Sanskrit stotra, just 10 minutes, at least 10 minutes, even if you don't understand, it's okay. Utter, the very sound will purify your body. Sanskrit has got that capacity. The very sound, the very energy will purify your body. There is something called sabda tattva. Means, when the air travels from your navel to the tongue, the sabda tattva only changes the air into words. If the sabda tattva is not there, only air will come out. No, words will come. In other languages, the sabda tattva is used I can say the more you utter the words in other language, the more you become tired. But in Sanskrit, the Sabda Tattva gets strengthened. The more you chant, more you will feel energetic. Every word strengthens the Sabda Tattva. It's like automatically the generator itself recharges the battery. And the battery runs the generator. It is completely interconnected. When you utter the Sanskrit words, the Sabda Tattva gets strengthened, and then again the Sabda Tattva creates more perfect words. Again the Sabda Tattva gets strengthened. The Sabda Tattva, which converts air into words, air into sound, that Sabda Tattva gets strengthened by Sanskrit. That is why, even if you don't understand, it's okay. If you understand, nice. Even if you don't understand, the very sound, the very vibration has got its own effect on our being. Now the modern day researchers prove the sounds, the Vedic mantras, the vibrations straight away enters into your body and removes the impurities. That is why our masters say again and again, chant these mantras, doing the puja or the homa, doing all these offerings with the Sanskrit mantra. The Sanskrit is so powerful, it can purify your whole being. Your whole being. The very energy will be transformed. Beautifully, Arjuna asks, O Lord, what is Brahman? What is self? What are fruitive activities? And what is the material manifestation? And what are the demigods? And Madhusudana, how does he live in the body? How can those engaged in devotion or those who are practicing the eternal consciousness know you at the time of death? He puts continuously questions. Now we have to understand one thing. Just yesterday I was reading one version of Mahabharata. I seriously thought, Arjuna is a Kshatriya, means a person who is a king, who is ruling the country. He cannot be so dumb, putting the same questions again and again and again in different ways. Why is he putting the same questions again and again? In different ways. When I was reading that Mahabharata's another one version, it says, Arjuna is also embodiment of Krishna. They say the incarnation of Nara and Narayana. Two divine energies of Vishnu, one came as Arjuna, the another one came as Krishna. So the whole drama is happening so that the Gita will come out for all of us. Otherwise, even a third-rate disciples will not have so many questions, and again, now the subject which he is bringing up is asking so many questions. One important thing you should understand, if you are putting so many questions, be very clear, you are not ready to wait for answers. You are not even interested in answer. Just you are expressing. It's almost like catharsis. Almost like catharsis. Here, Arjuna goes on putting so many questions. And in the end, he puts an important question. How the person who is engaged in practicing your teachings know you at the time of death? Here starts the whole teaching. He reveals the secrets of death. And one thing I want to tell you, West has spent all its energy to know life. East has spent all its energy to know death. Like our rishis, nobody has achieved such a deep experiences of death. Our masters have really done something great by bringing the knowledge of death to the people who are living. People always ask me, Swamiji, why should I know about death? Knowing about life is enough. After all, I'm a young person. Knowing about life is enough. Why should I know about death? The very word death creates fear in people. There are so many who don't want to hear the word death. They are ready to talk about anything else. They are ready to listen to any other subject. When it comes to death, they are not ready to listen. And they always think, why should we know about death? If you know about life, that is enough. Please be very clear. Your understanding about death is going to impact your understanding about life. Life and death are two different sides of a same coin. Just understand this one thing. All the Eastern religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, all Eastern religions talk about many births, reincarnation. All Western religion, Judaism and Christianity, Islam, all these religions talk about only single birth, one birth. This concept of reincarnation has influenced our society so deeply, nobody bothers about time. We don't bother at all about time. In India, we don't bother. People are so relaxed. Till morning 10 o'clock, you can see people will be sitting in tea shop. If you ask anything, if not today, tomorrow. If not tomorrow, next janma. We have eternity in front of us. We have eternity in front of us. We are not in hurry. We are not running behind anything. People are utterly relaxed. People are completely relaxed. In the West, whatever you have to achieve, you have to finish it in the 75-80 years. You don't have time. Either you live now or never. That is the reason people run. Understand? Understanding about death influences the whole social structure. Your whole thinking system, your whole mentality can be transformed. Your whole way of thinking can be transformed when you understand the secret of death. I just gave you one example. Why the idea of reincarnation, how the idea of reincarnation has influenced the Eastern society, and how the idea of one birth has influenced the Western society. There are so many thousands of examples you can give. I just gave you this single example so that you will understand our idea, our understanding about death is much more important than understanding about life itself. Whether you understand or not, life is going to be same. But with the death, the moment you understand, whole quality of death will change. Whole quality of your consciousness will change. The moment you realize the truth of death, the moment you experience, I can say one thing, you don't even have to experience, even if you intellectually understand, it is enough. When it comes to death, even your intellectual understanding is enough, it will transform your whole way of thinking. That is why, the moment you think of Yama, your whole life will have Yama. In Sanskrit, we have same word, yama and yama, both are same word, same spelling. Death and discipline, for both we use the same word. Death we use the word yama, for discipline we use the same word yama. Of course, just for your sake I pronounce it a little different way, but spelling is same. Same spelling. Patanjali, the first sutra of Patanjali, the first step of Patanjali is yama. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyagara, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. This Ashtanga Yoga, the first part is yama. And our death is also yama. If you understand death, your whole life will be automatically disciplined. It's strange, but honest discipline will happen in your life. Why I say strange but honest? Because always our discipline is hypocrisy. Always our discipline is hypocrisy. Suddenly a new kind of discipline will happen, which is very strange, but which will be totally honest. Why I use the word strange? Just yesterday, somebody gave me a question. I think must be a person who is well read in Bhagavata. From somewhere he brought the reference of Bhagavata. Swamiji, you said Krishna is an enlightened man. And he was a brahmachari. But he made love to Gurja. How can that be possible? The name Gurja, unless you read Bhagavata very deeply, you will not be able to find. She is supposed to be the maid servant of Krishna. She is supposed to be the maid servant of Krishna. Somebody who has read Bhagavata very deeply has put this question. What you ask is true. There is a record in Bhagavata that Krishna lived with Kubja. We need to understand that word. Brahmacharya does not mean celibacy. I have not told Krishna is celibate. I told Krishna lived with Brahman, the consciousness of Brahman. Here you translated that word into celibate. The moment you translate, the meaning is lost. Krishna, his inner space was totally pure. He was untouched. Let me tell you a small story. Once Vyasa goes to attend some function, some program. After having feast, he comes back. He is supposed to cross the river to go to his ashram. He stands near the river and says, if I am doing fasting, if I am observing my Ekadasi fasting, let this river give way so that I can walk and reach my ashram. Immediately the river opens, just Vyasa walks, all his disciples follow him, they reach the ashram. Disciples are surprised, what is this master? Just now in front of us, you ate and you had a feast. You come out and tell in front of the river, if I am fasting, if I am observing my Ekadasi, let this river give way. And the river gives way. You came here. How can this be? How can this happen? Vyasa says, when you eat with the consciousness that you are not the body, you will never feel that you are touched by the food. You will never feel that you had the food. You are eating or you are digesting. You are living. Just the body ate, I don't know anything about it. Of course, very difficult to understand this concept which I am explaining. Very difficult to understand. Easily you can cheat yourself with this idea. Please be very clear. Easily, very easily you can cheat yourself with this idea. You can also start telling, I am. Very easily we can cheat ourselves with this idea. The big problem is, with all great truths, there is a danger that you can misuse it and abuse it. Even with atomic energy, You can use it for good purposes. You can serve with atomic energy the whole humanity, or you can destroy, you can abuse the humanity with that energy. Atomic energy is like a satya. You can use it or abuse it. This truth is also like atomic energy. If you really want, you can use it. Otherwise, you can abuse it. People ask me, how can I find out whether I am really feeling the out of body consciousness or not? How can I also start living like Vyasa? Please be very clear, when you reach the state of the Vyasa, you will not even have this question. People come and ask me, Swamiji, please tell me, did I reach that Vyasa state already? Can I also start living like Vyasa? If you reach that state, you will not have even this doubt. Vyasa says, after eating, he says, I am fasting. Because he never feels connected to his body. He never feels his body is related to him, untouched. His inner space is so pure. His inner space is filled with bliss. He is not touched by anything. Nothing touches him. Ramakrishna, if you read the Ramakrishna's life, he did so many different kinds of spiritual practices. As far as I know, Ramakrishna is the only master who has performed so much of tapasya, so much of spiritual practices, so many different kinds of sadhanas. He did tantra sadhana. There are so many different kinds of practices. Ordinary person cannot even imagine of doing that. Because if an ordinary person starts the tantra sadhana, naturally straight away you will fall. He will straight away fall. The greatness or purity of Ramakrishna, his inner space was never touched by any of these outer things. His inner space was so pure, filled with bliss, he was able to complete all the tantra sadhana successfully. The tantra sadhana which is supposed to be done with so many panchamakaras, so many things, he was able to complete, he was able to successfully achieve because his inner space was pure. Here, you put the question, how can you say Krishna is Brahmachari? Please understand, his inner space was so pure, he was never touched by body consciousness. He never experienced he has got body, and never he came down to ordinary body consciousness. Let me tell you one more thing. It is not so easy to live with so many women and to survive. Please be very clear. If you start living, then you will understand. Then you will understand, and when I say women, I mean men also. If you understand, if you live with a single man or woman, then you will understand how difficult it is to live with the person. The other person naturally has to create hell. No other way. By their very quality, when the other person enters into your life, the hell will be created. Here you see somebody who is living with so many persons, but who is able to manage, who is able to be blissful. That itself shows his inner space was never touched. His inner space was so pure. His inner space was radiating bliss. The person whose inner space is filled with bliss and energy will never be touched by any impurity. By any impurity. Of course, little difficult concept to understand. But I tell you, the moment you understand the death, you will understand the single concept, the single idea. somebody goes to Janaka Raja. Janaka is supposed to be an enlightened king who was enjoying the world on enlightenment. This guy goes to Janaka Raja, a sannyasi, and starts questioning him. How can you say you are an enlightened when you are enjoying all these things? The sannyasis are always jealous of the people who are enjoying the life. That's the truth actually. Because these guys are missing what to do. You see, if you really experience bliss, joy inside, and consciously if you have left the world, you will never feel jealous. But for some reason you left, you don't know whether you will have the outer world or not. And you escape thinking that you will have inner world. And there also nothing is solid. You don't know what is going on. And you don't know whether you will get it or not. So naturally now what to do? How to console themselves? Start abusing householders. Start disrespecting householders. Start telling them, you people, you don't know, you are not living properly, you are not doing this, you are not doing that. That is why continuously, from time immemorial, the people who took that life will always condemn this life. Have you seen a single householder being jealous of Swamis? You will not find. But I have seen hundreds of people who took sannyas life jealous of householders. Because they feel something is missing. Something is not there. This guy went and started talking, asking Janaka, how can you say you are enlightened and have both? Janaka said, please stay in the palace next 1 or 2 days. Then I will talk to you. Because now I am too busy, there is a party is going on. In his palace the party is going on, the lot of dance, singing and dancing is going on. I am too busy, now I have no time to talk all these philosophical things. I will talk to you tomorrow or day after tomorrow, please just stay in the palace. They gave him food, they gave food for sannyasi and they made all the arrangements. Just on his bed, they made a knife to hang in a very thin thread. Sannyasi asked, why are you hanging this knife just exactly on my head? Janaka said, the workers, palace workers said, we don't know, but this is the order of our king. You have to sleep here only. No other way. Whole day was sitting, whole night he was sitting, thinking of this knife. When it will fall, how to escape? Next day morning, he comes to Janaka. Janaka asks, oh Swami, did you enjoy your stay? How did you sleep? Swami says, what are you asking? You know what you have done. Now why are you asking this question? You know what you have done. How can I sleep when a knife is hanging just on my head? I don't know when the knife will fall on me, when I will be killed. How can I sleep? How can I think of anything? How can I even dream of sleeping? Janaka laughs. When death is in front of you, you can't do anything. Your whole life changes. Same way, I know death is in front of me. Knife is hanging. When I know the knife is hanging over my head, my whole consciousness lives in an unaffected way by this whole palace. Just because of one knife, you are not able to enjoy the beautiful bed, beautiful palace. Must have been air conditioned. Those days, air conditioning. In those days also air conditioning existed. They used to put a ice bars and bricks So the whole day the ice bar will be there without melting, but the cool breeze will come through that ice bars. If you go to North Indian palaces, you can see the arrangement, the olden time air conditioning. Air conditioning is there, bed is there, everything is there, but you are not able to sleep just because of one knife. Same way, even though all these things are there, my inner space is not touched. My inner space is pure because I know clearly any moment death can happen. The death is hanging in front of me. Yama can make a strange but yama in your life. Just to go for experience. Just understand intellectually, your whole thinking will change. Your whole living will be transformed. Whole life will be new. You will not go out as the same person. You will not leave this hall as the same person. Your very being can be transformed. The very core can be touched. Krishna starts with the secrets. He starts explaining the secrets of death. Adibhudam sharobhava purushaschadi daivatam adiyanyohamevatra dehe dega prudamvaraha. O best of embodied beings, the physical nature, which is constantly changing, is called Adibhuta. The universal form of the Lord, which includes all the demigods, like those of the sun and moon, is called Adidaiva. And I, the Supreme Lord, represented as the super soul in the heart of every embodied being, am called Adiyanya. He just answers all the questions in single sutra. Comes to the main subject. Now he starts the main subject, revealing the secrets of death. Andakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram yapra yadi samadbhavam yadi nastyatra samsayah. Whoever at the end of his life quits his body, remembering me alone, at once attains my nature. Of this there is no doubt. Why should he say the word nasti atra samsaya? Why should he say the word there is no doubt? He is emphasizing this is truth. He is taking the oath. Usually in my meditation camps, before starting my discourse on the death, actually, they have one full 2 days, one camp, full 2 days program, just on this one sutra. I have designed a meditation program called Nityananda Spurana. In India, we conduct 4 days. Here, I do it as a 2 days program. Because in this country, even if God comes, he has to come in the weekend. Otherwise, you will tell, just give the card, please get back to me, you can mail me. I'll get back to you. If God comes on other days than weekend, he will get only email ID. We do a 2 days program. This single sutra, the whole program is based on this single sloka. Before starting the camp, I always used to take the oath. Hereby I take whatever I am going to speak is truth. Because there are some truths which cannot be logically expressed, which cannot be explained in the logic which you understand. You need to have little patience to listen. The big problem with our mind is anything which is not presented in logical form, either you start putting questions, arguing, you start refuting, or you refuse it, you straight away don't want to listen. Otherwise, you will hear just like one more novel story. One more story, it will not go into your being. You will just think, all right, and here I have come all the way, let me sit and see what he says. You will allow the speaker to speak, but you will not listen. That's the reason I always tell people, before I start talking about death, I tell them, hereby I promise what I am going to speak is pure satya. If you are interested, take this, digest it and transform your life. If you don't, it's okay, up to you. It is your choice. Krishna says, nastyatra samsayaha, because he is going to speak something which is beyond logic. If you want to know about the outer world, logic is the basic thing you need. Only with logic you can understand the whole thing, outer world. When you want to know the inner world, you need a master who will take you beyond the logic. Logic cannot give you the inner world. Logic can give you the outer world. It cannot give you the inner world. Let you understand this one example. This one example will help you. For example, here is a formula. X into 2 is 4. Now we have to find what is the value of X. To find out the value of X, what you are supposed to do? You should say, first let us assume X is 2. Then replace 2 in the place of X. Then 2 into 2 is 4. When you know 2 into 2 is 4, it matches. Now you can conclude X is equal to 2. Once the calculation is done, now you know X is equal to 2. But when I say first line, let us assume X is equal to 2, immediately you start questioning, why not 3? Why not 4? Why should it be 2? I have no answer. Till the end, till I solve the problem, you need to have little patience. All I need is only this few minutes of patience. Till I solve the problem. Here Krishna says, nastyatra samsayaha, no doubt, what I am speaking is truth. Please just wait, let me finish the calculation, then you yourself will understand. The end of the calculation, you know X is equal to 2, but in the starting, you need to believe the master's word and work out. Till you realize it for few minutes, till it becomes experience for few minutes, you need to accept the master's word as it is. When you calculate, when you finish the calculation, naturally it will become your understanding. It will start as my understanding. In the end, it will become your understanding. When it becomes your understanding, naturally, you yourself will see the truth behind these words. Now Krishna starts, andakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram yaprayadi samatbhav yadi nastyatra samsayaha. Whoever at the end of his life quits his body, remembering me alone, at once attains my nature. Of this there is no doubt. Why he says about remembering me alone, that also. At the end of his life, quits his body, remembering me alone, at once attains my nature. Now we should understand the whole secret of how we take the body and how we live through and how we leave. Please understand, your whole body is created by you out of your fear, greed, guilt, your engraved memories, samskaras. Whatever samskaras you have, to work them out, to experience them, to enjoy them, you create the body. The body is created according to your samskaras. Once you create the body, when you live your life, you don't live only the samskaras which created this body. You accumulate some more samskaras. For example, from here you take $10,000 and go to downtown to buy some things. On the way you meet one of your friend. He says, let's go to Universal Studio. Let's go to Disneyland. You go here and there and blow the whole thing, whole money. And then when you go to the downtown to buy what you want to buy, you are already broke. Now, next immediate thing is credit card. Credit card. You do what you buy, whatever you want to buy through credit card, come back and live your whole life just to pay the credit card. Actually, it is a cunning technique. It's a cunning technique to keep man under the slavery conditions. Of course, let us not talk about that now. When it comes to the, there's a separate subject. That time we will touch the, when I speak about the desires, the ichcha shakti, the energy of desires will touch that. Now let us enter into the main subject. Anyhow, you come back and suddenly you feel that you are not having sufficient things. If you go and buy what you want to buy for the $10,000 and come back, you won't have any problem. Because you saw your friend and started accumulating his desires also. Please understand, you accumulated his desires also. You have fulfilled his desires also. Maybe through your body, but the desire is from him. His desire also you worked out, fulfilled. Now you feel you don't have sufficient money. You don't have enough of things. Same way, when you came down to this planet Earth, you came with enough of energy to work out your samskaras. That is what Mahavira means when he says, God never sends you empty-handed. He sends you with everything. Whatever desires you bring, whatever samskaras you bring, when you come to this planet Earth, you bring enough energy to live that samskaras. The prarabdha karma means the samskaras which you are going to work out in this life. We have three level karmas. Sanchita, Agamya, Prarabdha. Sanchita karma is all the files which are in the bank locker. Your own bank locker. All the files which are in the bank locker. Next, Agamya is files which are in your archives, in your office archives. Prarabdha is files which are in your table. You have to finish all three files to complete your life. The files which are in the bank locker is Sanchita. The files which are in the your archives, office archives, is Agamya. The files which are on the table is Prarabdha. Prarabdha karma is the karma which you have brought to work out on this life. You have to work out this prarabdha in this life. You have brought enough energy to live these karmas. Then why do we feel life is not sufficient? why do we feel that we are not fulfilled? The problem is, after coming down, you forget what for you came down, what all the samskaras you brought, what all the desires you brought, and what you brought you forgot, and started accumulating more and more desires from family, friends and society. Put all their desires, all their desires in your life. For example, if your neighbor gets a new sari, this all only in India. Here you don't know who is neighbor. Even the neighbor's name you don't know. Here you don't even know the neighbor's name. That's true. One of our devotee in Oklahoma, he told me, neighbor passed away 6 months ago. After 6 months only he came to know that neighbor passed away. After 6 months only he came to know neighbor passed away. Of course, when you in India, the lifestyle is totally different. When a neighbor gets a sari, new sari, immediately you think, I should also get one. Her desire, you are trying to work out. Naturally, you will run short of energy. You will run short of money. You will run short of time. You will run short of everything. When you start living others' desires in your life, you will feel deeply discontented. Because what you brought will not be sufficient. It's like going to the downtown with a plan and a particular amount of money. And suddenly, your plan has changed. Naturally, you will run short of things. Here also on the planet Earth, after coming down, you forget that what samskaras you brought, and you start collecting more and more desires from society, the social conditioning. Because of that social conditioning, all advertisements, please be very clear, all advertisements are going to make you poor. They will become rich, no doubt, but you will become poor. Continuously the ideas are put in your head, especially ideas, advertisement which touches your muladhara. These advertising agencies, they know anything touches your muladhara will be recorded in your system. When I say muladhara, anything related to sex appeal will be recorded in your system. That is why, whether it is soap or shampoo or cloth or car, anything will always be promoted with that one line, sex appeal. Because straight away it will get recorded in your system. It will get recorded in your system. Automatically, when you go to the shop, you will ask for that product. But you forget one thing. When you pay a few dollars, you will get only the soap, not that model. You will not get that model also along with the soap. You forget that important fact. When it gets recorded, soap and the model who is using the soap, both the visions, both the pictures are recorded in your system. But you forget, you are going to get only soap. Whatever is recorded in your muladhara goes so deep, you act exactly with that idea. That idea automatically expresses in you. Whatever is put inside your being, through advertisement or through inspiration, through some way, naturally, that is going to create more and more trouble for your being. When you accumulate things, desires from outside, automatically you will feel your energy, your life is not sufficient. There is a beautiful story in Mahabharata. Mahabharata is, and Yamadharma came. Yama says, now your life is over, O king, please come, let's go. This guy says, what is this? You are giving me such a beautiful kingdom. and such beautiful life, such wonderful wives, kids. You have given me everything, but 100 years is too short. Please bless me. I must be here 100 more years. Yama says, no, no extension is possible. No extended stay. No extension is possible. Please come. No, extension is not allowed. He somehow begs, no, 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 please bless me. At 100 years, Yama says, all right. If any one of your sons, if they give their life, then I will extend. As exchange offer. Some one son agrees, all right, for the sake of father, I will give my life. So the exchange father, exchange offer worked out. He had 100 more years. After 100 years, Yama appears. Suddenly this king realizes and says, what is this? I asked you 100 years, you have come so soon. Yamadharma says, 100 years is already over. What are you talking? And he somehow, please, please understand me. I don't even know 100 years is over. Please somehow help me. Give me one more extension. Yamadharma says, no, this is too much. We can't go for second extension. Somehow begs. Finally, he gets one more extension. Next time, Yamadharma comes, again, the king is in the same mood. He says, what is this, you have come so soon? Now, Yama starts. Yama gives a beautiful teaching. He says, by pouring the ghee, you can never put the fire off. Same way, by offering or by fulfilling your desires, you can never feel fulfilled. You can never feel the fulfillment. Now it is time, you have to come. Of course, he leaves. By fulfilling, you will never feel fulfilled. You will never feel the contentment. Here, when you acquire more and more desires from the more and more samskaras from the outer world, naturally you will feel the life is not sufficient. You are not given enough of things. Understand? In the end, somehow anyhow, you pull, you leave. In the end of the life, when you leave the body, how you live, the whole scene, for example, if you live 70 years, the whole 70 years will appear in your being fast as a fast-forward moment. The whole thing will again happen in your consciousness, so that the decision about the next birth will be taken. Now you have the karmas which you have not enjoyed or experienced, which you brought and which you accumulated from the society, which you have not finished it. Both are there. And I wanted to give you one more understanding. Karma means the desire which is not completely experienced by you. As a nature, you are a fulfilled being. You are Atman. Whenever you don't fulfill any action completely with your totality, you create an hangover. You create a recorded memory of that action. That recorded memory, samskara, is not only a dead memory, it has got power to make you again and again do the same action. Samskara is a living energy. Please be very clear, samskara is a living energy. It has got power to make you do the same action again and again. It will make you travel in the same path again and again. That is why it is called engraved memories. Engraved memories are not dead thoughts. They are living energy in your being. The more you travel in that path, the more it will be strengthened. If you have lived a single samskara totally, completely, that samskara will leave you. It will drop your being. You will be liberated from it. Whatever you have not lived completely, only remains as a samskara in you, as a karma in you. Here, you brought something and you have not experienced those remaining karmas and which you accumulated newly. The whole thing will appear in front of you at the time of leaving the body, so that you will be able to decide the next janma. It's like a, if you are supposed to make an important decision, you call for all the files, all the old files also. You call for the whole archive files before taking the important decision. Now you are going to decide important things, where to take birth, what type of parents to choose, what will be the right place, what type of family to choose, whether to choose the male body or female body. All these decisions you are supposed to take. Please be very clear, all these decisions are taken by your consciousness, not by anybody else. But your consciousness is influenced by this data which you have collected when you live in this planet Earth. Your consciousness is influenced, your will is influenced by the data which you have collected when you live in the planet Earth. Otherwise, the decision is purely made by you. One important thing you should understand, even the sense enjoyments looks like enjoyment because from the young age you are taught this is enjoyment. One important research I read in a book called Hidden Mysteries of African Tribal People. About the African tribal people, this is their lifestyle. This is the lifestyle of African tribal people. The recordings, the research, they say these tribal people don't know anything called joy or sense pleasures. It is not that they don't live. They eat good food, not food, good human beings. They eat everything. They taste, they smell, they listen, they are able to see, they will have the pleasure of touch, they have everything. But they don't have the idea something is pleasure. Because they don't have the idea it is pleasure, they don't run behind it. Because they are not conditioned, they are not taught it is pleasure, they don't run behind it. I lived near Omkareshwar with a small group of tribal people near Omkareshwar. And really I was surprised the way in which they are living. Nobody, not even a single person is depressed. Please understand, what I am saying is truth, honest truth. Human beings can live on the planet Earth without getting depressed. I was surprised, the whole village, I lived with them for months, not even a single person is depressed. And nobody is running behind sense pleasures. Really, I was surprised. How can these people run, these people live without running behind sense pleasures? Because they are not even taught that there is something called sense pleasures. The very corruption, the basic corruption has not happened. And one more interesting thing I want to tell you. When I was living with the tribal people, I was living in a small temple. The center of the village, there is a small temple. I was living there. Suddenly one day they erected a small hut. One pregnant lady came and entered the hut. After half an hour, she came out with a small baby. No pain, no doctor, no attendant, no medicine, no screening. In half an hour she came out walking with baby. I was shocked. Of course, I was not able to ask because first of all I don't know their language, and the another thing, immediately we can't ask. After a month, again they put same hut once more. Another lady came, pregnant lady, came alone, entered the hut. After half an hour, she came out with baby. Now it is too much. That local priest who comes to do the their kind of worship to the temple, I slowly asked him, how is it happening? Don't they have the pain? He told me, pain? Why pain? I was surprised. They don't have pain at the time of delivery. The very idea women should have pain at the time of delivery doesn't exist in their society. And not only that, nobody suffers with the menopause problems. Nobody suffers with any diseases related to women. Then I started inquiring about their lifestyle. Then I understood they respect women. Women are never disrespected. They are never said, you became impure in the monthly time. The women are never taught, they are somewhere low. Women are never conditioned, they are impure. Again and again they are respected. The moment a girl becomes mature, she is respected. Now you are qualified to become mother. She is respected. People go and fall at her feet and she touches and heals the people. They have belief in the period time when a woman touches a person's head and blesses, he will be healed. Women are respected because the conditioning is totally different. Nobody suffers the pain. In the regular so-called civilized society, women are disrespected. Again and again they are taught, this is impurity. You are not pure enough. This is not right. Stand here, stand there. Especially in India, it is torture. It's just torture. And the wrong conditioning, just because of the wrong conditioning, these people suffer the pain. They suffer and struggle with the pain. If they are not taught, they will never suffer. This research scholar who did the research on these African tribals, he says, they don't know anything called pleasure. Because of that, they don't run behind the pleasure. It is actually your social conditioning which makes you run behind anything. It is your social conditioning which is taught to you which makes anything as pleasure or pain. Even this idea that what kind of life I will choose, the next life, what kind of body I will take, this decision you take according to your social conditioning. What you think as the highest thing in the life, you take decisions to achieve that. What is kept as an ideal in front of your eyes, you automatically run behind that. In this whole life, what you think as the highest ideal, only that will come to your mind when you leave the body. Krishna says, Andha kalecha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram. How you condition your mind? If you think eating is the highest thing in the life, when you leave the body, what will come in front of you? All kinds of idli dosa and McDonald's towers. Nothing else will come. In India, you enter into any village, you will see a temple tower. And you will remember the divine. Here, go in the highway, any county, first what you will see? McDonald's tower. First thing which falls in your eyes is McDonald's tower. If you are taught eating is the highest thing in the life, naturally what will appear when you leave the body? Only burgers and all kinds of food. Then naturally you will decide, Anyhow, eating is the highest thing in the life. Let me decide the country where I can eat, 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 and eat. Let me take up the body which will help me to eat more and more and more. Let me go and take birth in a family where I will be given only food, nothing but food, where I will not have any other responsibility, where I will not be given any responsibility. You choose. You call for all the files. All the files are brought to your table. Now, the gist is there in front of you. The essence of the whole file, all your archives, the research report is there. What you think as best thing, what for you work in your life. Based on that report, now you decide, all right, let me take birth in this country. If I want to eat, this is the right country. If you live throughout your life in tamas, means in dullness, not doing anything, pure laziness. One guy, small story, one guy goes to a doctor and says, doctor, please examine me. I am not feeling like doing anything. I feel always dull. Doctor thoroughly examines him. Then this guy asks, doctor, please tell me in a plain English, what is my problem? Doctor says, if you ask me in a plain English, you are just lazy. Nothing else is a problem. Then he says, all right, now tell me the medical term. I have to go and tell my wife. Now give me the medical term for this problem. I have to go and tell my wife. If you have lived that kind of life, a pure, dull, dead, lazy life, and I have seen sometimes this amazing kind of laziness. If you want to see the ultimate laziness, come to Himalayas. Really, you can see some strange kind of laziness. That is why Vivekananda says, the people who eat and sleep in the name of sannyas, make them stand and beat them. He says straight away in his lectures. He says very clearly, you should beat them. Pure laziness. One guy says to his friend, if somebody invents a machine, if we switch on, if that does all our work, laundry, cleaning, cooking, ironing, and putting the clothes, giving bath to us, if everything, if that machine does just by switching it on, how nice it will be. The other friend says, if that machine also automatically switches on it by itself, if automatically gets on, how nice that will be. Peak of laziness. If you live throughout your life spending your whole energy in laziness, please be very clear, you spend energy when you are lazy. Don't think you are not spending energy. Have you heard of this thing? Tired of sleeping? Tired of taking rest? There are so many people who are tired of taking rest. If you sleep more than few hours, you will be tired actually. If you sleep more than 10 hours, try to get up, you will be tired of taking rest. Tired of taking rest is what tamas. If you live the life completely in tamas, naturally you desire. Anyhow, the ultimate thing in the life is sleep. That's all. Now then, which country is the right country? What type of body is the right body? Whether pig or buffalo or human being? And which family? What type of family I should take birth? You sit and decide. Please be very clear. The whole calculation happens based on your data. The data which you have collected. At the time of leaving the body, the whole data appears to you in a single moment, in one flash. The gist of the whole data, gist of all the three files, the Agamya file, Sanjita file and Prarabdha file, appears in front of you. Based on that file, you decide what I am supposed to do? What should be my next birth? The moment you decide, you enter into that kind of body. One more thing, important thing. Because you are so attached to this body and mind, you cannot live without body more than three kshana. Three kshana. Kshana means in Sanskrit, not second. Gap between one thought and the other thought. When you have lived in this body, if you experienced at least once the thoughtlessness, if you are able to, thoughtlessness means being alive without body and mind. If you experience the thoughtless awareness, if you remain alive, if you are conscious, even for a single moment, without body and mind, that is what I call samadhi, thoughtlessness. Let me give you a small diagram, then you will be able to understand what I exactly mean by the word thoughtlessness. In your life, you experience two states of beings and two levels of mind. One is the mind when you have thoughts and without thoughts. For example, now you have thoughts. In the deep sleep, do you have thoughts? No. So with thoughts, without thoughts. Same way, in the being, with eye consciousness and without eye consciousness. As on now, you all have that idea, eye consciousness. In the deep sleep, do you have? No, the eye consciousness doesn't exist. With eye consciousness, without eye consciousness. These two levels of consciousness and two levels of mind crisscross each other and create four states of being. With thoughts, with eye consciousness, it is called waking state, Jagratavastha, in which most of us are now. Not all, there are few who are in dream state. Almost, most of you are in this state now. Waking state. With thoughts, with the eye consciousness. Now you have the consciousness of eye and thoughts, both. And the next thing, you will have thoughts, but the eye will not be there. That is dream. You may ask, how? The frequency of thoughts will be more than the frequency of the consciousness in your dream. That is why you will not be able to control your dreams. Now, please understand, then you can take the notes. First you can understand, then you will be, you can take the notes. See, now frequency of I is more. That is why you can control your thoughts, suppress them, divert them, create them, do anything you want. Because the frequency of I is more than the frequency of thoughts. The dream state, the frequency of thoughts is more than frequency of I. That is why you cannot control your dreams. If we can have the dreams of our choice, you know what kind of dreams we will always be having. Dreams are not under your control. You can't have choice because the frequency of thoughts is more than frequency of consciousness. So you have thoughts but no consciousness. Just thoughts flowing in your being is what is dreaming. Next state, neither I exist nor the thoughts exist. This is called deep sleep. Deep sleep. This is called sushupti. Jagrat, swapna, sushupti. Conscious, subconscious, unconscious. And there is a fourth state which we have not experienced in our life, where you will not have thoughts, but you will have eye consciousness. Pure eye consciousness. This is what I call samadhi, thoughtless awareness, turiyavastha, atmanjnana, brahmanjnana, self-realization, nirvana, atmanubhuti, state of divine, nitya consciousness, eternal bliss, what not. All these words point this state only, where you will have the pure awareness, consciousness, but not thoughts, where you will learn, where you will live without body and mind. In all these three states, you live with body and mind. Here you live with the body which you are having now, the sthula sarira. Here you live with the body sukshma sarira. Please understand, in dream also you assume a body. That is why you are able to travel. For example, you will be sleeping in Los Angeles, but suddenly you dream as if you are in India. It means you travel with a body called subtle body, sukshma sarira. In deep sleep, you have a body called kasal body, karana sarira. Here, you experience boundarylessness, bodilessness. You become degatrayadhitaha, kalatrayadhitaha. Where you have a pure eye consciousness, with eye, without thoughts. Vivekananda says, if you experience even a single glimpse of this consciousness when you are alive, when you leave the body, the same thing will automatically repeat and you will leave the body in samadhi. You will leave the body in samadhi. All spiritual practices, directly or indirectly, aim only to achieve this state. They aim only to achieve this state, where you will be able to be conscious without body and mind. That is what here Krishna says. If you experienced at least single one moment of consciousness without body and mind, only then you can choose your next life in a relaxed way. For example, if you have not lived even a single moment without body and mind, you cannot be without body and mind. You will immediately try to run and catch the next body. The moment you die, because you never lived even a single moment without body and mind, you will rush as early as possible. You will not bother in which train you are getting into. You will just get into any train comes. You will say, after that let us manage, first let us get into the train. You will run and get into some train and come down to the planet Earth. And after coming down, you will, after coming down again you forget. That's another one big problem. The whole thing is confusion leading to confusion and confusion leading to confusion. When you are living, if you experience at least a single moment of complete rest, thoughtless awareness, without the body and thoughtless awareness, naturally at that moment you live without body and mind. That is what is called thoughtless awareness. Because when you are in the thoughtless awareness, all three bodies don't touch you. You experience awareness which is beyond all of these three bodies. If you experienced that thoughtless awareness even for a single moment, in the end when you leave the body, you will have the clarity, you will have the patience to work with all your data. You will see the data line by line and then you will decide, should we take birth at all? What is the need? Sometime, if at all you want to take birth, you will take the birth of Yoga Prashta. Arjuna Krishna says, Yoga Prashta. You will take birth in a family which will be very conducive for your spiritual practices. Who will not say anything, who will not put obstacles when you want to do spiritual practices. It is very rare, Krishna says, very rare souls take birth in that type of families. I have seen very rare parents who don't object when a son is doing some spiritual practice. If your parents are not objecting, if your family is not disturbing, please be very clear, you are Yoga Prashta. There is every chance of you being Yoga Prashta. Otherwise, even if your parents are religious, I have seen, the parents will be very religious, but if son wants to enter into a sannyas life or a spiritual life, they will put all obstacles. They will say, go to temple, but not to the ashrams. As long as you go to temple, things will go smooth. Because as long as you also grow to the level where we are, it's okay. But if you go ahead of us, it is something which we can't digest. And very rare souls take birth in the family, in the situation where you will not be disturbed. You will not be disturbed. Somehow, by divine grace, I had a blessing. When I was leaving the house for my parivarajaka life, for my sannyas life, I was a small boy. Of course, even now I am young, that is different. I was 17 and half. I told my mother that I am going. I wanted to leave the parivarajaka life. I wanted to taste the sannyas life. She started weeping, as usual. Then I asked, do you mean then I should not go? She said a beautiful word. No, I can't say you can't go. I am not able to digest, so I am weeping. She never stopped me. Still now I feel grateful because they did not stop me. Still now I always feel in the mind the gratitude, the grateful. They never stopped me. And not only that, even from the young age, I used to do all sorts of things. And you can't imagine. And I don't think any other parents would have tolerated it. But somehow that atmosphere, that I had the fortune, that such a beautiful atmosphere happened, I was able to continue my spiritual practice. Very rare people will have this blessing. If your whole family, if your surroundings are not disturbing you, helping you, please be very clear, you have taken conscious birth, means Yoga Prashta, the Janma of Yoga Prashta. If you have not experienced even a single glimpse, one moment of that thoughtless awareness, you cannot live without body and mind. So within three kshana, you take birth. You take birth. Now I should explain the concept of kshana. Kshana means gap between one thought and the other thought. When I say three kshana, if you have lived restless life, running, your three kshana will be micro million seconds, microseconds. It will not be even a second. One kshana will be microseconds. If you have lived a peaceful, blissful life, if you achieved at least one glimpse of thoughtless awareness, your one kshana can be even 200, 300 years. Your one kshana can be extended even to 200, 300 years. Because kshana means gap between one thought and the other thought. If you stop the next thought happening, your kshana can be extended to any extent. It can be extended to years. And a small example, Time is not chronological. Time is psychological. If you sit with a friend with whom you really feel comfortable, joyful, blissful, even after 3-4 hours, suddenly you will see the time and you will realize, oh, 3-4 hours passed. I don't know how the time fly, how the time has passed. The other example, if you are sitting with somebody who is continuously nagging you, with whom you don't feel comfortable, after every 5 minutes, what you will do?
Look at the watch.
Look at the watch, and you will think, why the watch is not moving? Is there any problem? Sometimes you will even think, why the watch is not moving? Because time is psychological, it is not chronological. Number of thoughts which happens in your mind decides the time consciousness. If the number of thoughts are less, even if you spend 10 hours, you will not feel the 10 hours passed. If the number of thoughts is more, even 2-3 minutes will look like years. Small story. One lady goes to the doctor for checkup. After a thorough checkup, doctor says, I have a bad news for you. You may live only 6 more months. At the most, you will live only 6 months more. 6 months is the time. She said, what is this suddenly you are telling? What to do now? Doctor says, I have one suggestion. Better marry an accountant. She asks, why? Will that cure me? Will it heal me? Doctor says, no, no. 6 months will look very long. If you marry an accountant, it will seem very long. At the most, you can extend the time by increasing the number of thoughts. If the number of thoughts are more, you will feel the time is not moving. You will feel time is not moving. That is why we say, the number of thoughts are less, more time will pass. You will not even know how the time is passing, how the time is disappearing. The number of thoughts are more. If you are restless, time will not move. That is why hell is always called eternal hell. Eternal, the word is not chronological. How can it be a justice? Even if you do all possible mistakes in 100 years, how can you be given eternal hell? 100 years mistake, 100 years hell, that's all. But that 100 years will look like an eternal. Because the thoughts, number of thoughts, it will not move. In Vedic calculation, we say, 1 year for human beings is 1 day for devatas. Because their number of thoughts per second is less. Their TPS is less. Because their TPS is less, the time, 1 year for us is 1 day for them. That is why Nataraja will have only 6 puja throughout the year. In one full year, they will worship Nataraja only 6 times. In Chidambaram temple, in India, Chidambaram temple, only 6 times they will do the Abhishekam for Nataraja. Because the devatas are doing the 6 puja. For them, our 1 year is 1 day for them. So for their 6 puja is conducting our 1 year. For devatas, devatas means whose TPS has come down, who is living, who has had the glimpse of samadhi. If your TPS is low, you are in heaven. If your TPS is high, you are in hell. Heaven always looks short. Hell always looks eternal because of number of thoughts. Here, when you are living in the body, if you have at least single glimpse of thoughtless awareness, experience of meditation, at the time of leaving the body, automatically this consciousness will come up. You will have 2 benefits. You can choose to become enlightened, not to take next birth at all. Or you can choose the right place to express, to work out your karmas to live as you want. You have both choice. If you experience thoughtless awareness, a glimpse of consciousness, even one moment of meditation, single moment of meditation, when you are living with body and mind, the NSP program which I do is straight away concentrated on this one concept. All I try to do is to give you a single glimpse of the consciousness, thoughtless awareness. Actually, if you achieve one glimpse of thoughtless awareness, you achieve whatever has to be achieved in the life. If you have not achieved one glimpse of samadhi, thoughtless awareness, whatever you achieve is not useful. Whatever you achieve is not useful. Please be very clear. The next step, Krishna explains how to experience thoughtless awareness and little more deeper understanding about death and art of living.